does it work actually? The microphone works?
Yeah.
Okay. So, thanks for inviting me to this workshop. Thank you very much. So, I'll tell you about physics of topological insulators, actually fractional versions of those. Generally, these are very complex, there are many complex systems, and I'll present a very simple approach to understand them and hopefully to build them in a simple way in experiments. So, you know, when you tell somebody what I work about topological phases, in the end, you have to define what you are talking about. So let's choose some possible definition. So, quantum physics, we have energy levels. The main effect in the integer quantum Hall effect, for example, which also has a gap, no order parameter, and so beautiful experimental system, it shows us mathematics. But you know, integer quantum Hall effect is already is an example of topological system, but it doesn't require electron-electron interactions to be there. But there is a second part of the definition, which is where Xiaodang Wen enters. So these are considered two-dimensional systems, and now actually there appear quite some finite number of ground states now, depending on the topology of the manifold you put the system on. For example, a torus would have some finite number of ground states, and you cannot tell at which ground state the system is. You cannot take the system from one ground state to the other as long as you just do local operators or local measurements. The way to bring the system from one ground state to another requires doing non-local operators, like going around the torus or something like this. And there is one-to-one correspondence to having quasi-particles with fractional statistics. And of course, we know examples of such system in experiment. This is the fractional quantum Hall effect, which is fractional charges. Very beautiful things. So one of the main motivations in the community to look at such fractionalized systems is that sometimes you have one extra level of interest, which is the non-abelian statistics of excitations. So imagine that you put 1, 2, 3, some finite number of quasi-particles in the system somehow. So now again, the number of ground states is going to grow exponentially, and it's not associated with some internal degree of freedom of quasi-particle. It's again some topological degeneracy that you cannot, again, you cannot tell in which state you are by any local measurement. In fact, the operators that bring system between different states are going to be topological braids, as it's shown here, as a function of time. You can braid particle 2 and 3, and then 1 and 2. And this would not commute with the first braiding 1 and 2, and then 2 and 3. And the dream is to use this as for doing topological quantum computation. Possibly these states are realized in some of the Hall plateaus. So what I want to tell you is that there is the realm of non-interacting topological insulators, which are kind of generalizations of quantum Hall effect, which you understand in some sense very well. We know to classify them. However, we understand much less the fractional version of them, and specifically there are not many experiments. There is just fractional quantum Hall effect in two-dimensional electron gas in graphene, but not much more. And situations that, actually, from point of view of methods, so methods are quite weaker for dealing with interacting topological phases. So what are the basic methods that we have? So basic method is based on either knowing the answer ahead, and being so really genius, and so we can describe, you can well describe a complicated state of electrons with very non-trivial topology. But this is by no way kind of derivation, a way to start from Hamiltonian and get there. Of course, people do very nice numerics. And sometimes you can actually fine-tune your Hamiltonian in order to be able to solve it exactly and say things precisely, but then it's really fine-tuned. So what we like to have, actually, is a simple way just to go from the beginning, let's say from the microscopic Hamiltonian into just understanding the properties of a solving a fractional state, and which possibly will lead to some ways to experimentally realize such states. So this is the wire construction that I will now introduce. And I'll give some kind of theoretical examples where you can apply it, and then possible experimental realizations which use this method. All right, so first of all, I'd like to start with some cartoon picture of what means a coupled wire construction. So we will be dealing mainly with two-dimensional systems. We'll start just from a quantum Hall. So if you have quantum Hall, then you have edge states, and now suppose that you raise the chemical potential here to deplete the electrons from some region, then you introduce edges, and now the way to reconnect these two pieces is basically you can allow for some weak tunneling between the edges. So this weak tunneling will always kind of involve the coupling between a left mover in one part and a right mover in the other part. This glues the two parts and opens a gap again. Very simple. So basically, you can go to the limit that you have many narrow stripes, essentially wires, and you can reconnect the system back to the original state if you now couple in this particular way. So the right moving mode of the J stripe with the left moving mode of the next one. So what I'll do now is actually very kind of style tutorial fashion, just explain how this was done in this actually kind of original paper in this direction, just to understand the integer quantum Hall effect from a collection of wires. So we start from a Hamiltonian, from just one-dimensional wires, H1D here, and some tunneling between them. Now there is a magnetic field B. It's convenient to work in gauge where vector potential is on the x direction, so parallel to the wires, is given by B times y. So it increases from wire to wire. So it means that the dispersion relation, the parabolas of each wire, is going to be shifted from wire to wire by some amount little b, which is proportional to the magnetic field B. Okay. Now what happens when you introduce some tunneling between the wires? So immediately you'll open gaps. So this is wire number one, wire number two. Now they will open a gap due to tunneling amplitude. And you encounter here a region, for example, this one, where you can place your Fermi energy, and then you'll be inside a gap. So in the bulk, there is a gap. For example, here, and we can check, for example, what would be. So we are imitating a two-dimensional system. using wires, but we can ask what is the density of two-dimensional electrons compared to the density of flux quanta. So what is the filling factor in this state? So you know, the density of two-dimensional electrons in this model is given by the density of each wire divided by the distance between the wires. So you need to know what is K Fermi of each wire. So in this case, it's like that we have 2KF is equal to the separation between parabolas, which is B. And it's kind of simple to show that the filling factor, you know, is the density of electrons divided by magnetic field, is given simply by 2KF, which is proportional to the electron density, divided by B. So right here, we have the 2KF is equal to B, therefore the filling factor is 1. And indeed, we have an energy gap in the bulk, and we have an edge state. We see here the left moving mode remaining from the first wire, which is not coupled to anything else. We can also have nu equal to 2 if you increase the density by a factor of 2. So we have the quantum Hall effect here in this simple description. What have we gained? So now the thing, what we have gained is, I want to claim, is simplicity. So the way to see the simplicity is actually to use, you know, idea.
What about the wave functions? Can you look on a specific minimum and show how the wave function would look?
Yeah, in this, I don't know if it will be convenient, but I can do this. Just Slater determinant of.
That would give a nice intuition for magnetic land and.
Of course, they look very different than the wave functions that we are used to, because the system is very anisotropic.
No, so, in the right thing, you also think about strength.
I think probably yes. I've not looked in this way in the problem. So you can gain simplicity actually by setting the gap to be to small values. So we are using, you know, adiabatic continuity. We are there is topological phase. We can go, we can change parameters as long as we don't close the gap. We stay in that phase. But there are certain limits which are very, very simple. So suppose that the tunneling becomes smaller and smaller, smaller compared to the Fermi energy of the wires. Okay, then what we get is basically the opening of the gap. It basically happens as just coupling of right mover of one wire, say wire number 2, with left mover of wire number 3. So it's really, in this limit, we really, as was in the previous slides, we have decomposed the problem to commuting one-dimensional link problems. So these link problems that couple, kind of there is a switch of partners. So left movers and right movers that do not belong to the same wire are here coupled. All right, so this is really simple. So what can we do with that, with this wire construction? So what I want to show now is that we can just immediately, essentially, get the fractional quantum Hall physics analytically without having to guess too much.
Yeah. May I ask a probably stupid question? So this k, usually k just goes from like minus pi to pi or something like that. And here it's extended because of the.
Well, there's no lattice, supposedly. In the absence of a lattice, there's no minus pi and pi.
Okay, so it should just be okay that it has this very broad range of values.
But so I guess next talk will be about the presence of a lattice, and there will be limits. But in continuing, we don't have to worry about that.
Maybe a related question. You said that this shows that the existence of edge states, right? But how do I use it as an edge state?
Because you see that, just you see in your eyes, that this left mover belongs to wire number 1. And here, if you are nu equal to 2, you see that there are two left movers, two chiral modes, which belong to wire number 1 and wire number 2. So they belong to the leftmost. So this picture really shows the integer quantum Hall effect. But I'd like to show it now with slight sophistication, not more than one sophistication of dealing with one interacting one-dimensional systems. You can now see the fractional quantum Hall effect. So now we are reducing the density, let's say, to filling factor 1/3. So initially we had 2KF equal to B. Now I have 2KF here is let's say nearly one third of B. It's much smaller than B. So the question is, do I get again this picture that left and right inverse open a gap in neighboring wires? And well, now the parabolas do not touch anymore. There is no, we don't see this immediately. However, we do know that we have to add interactions to the game. Fractional quantum Hall effect would not be there without interaction. That's certainly the case. So we should cook up a related process in which electron tunnels, but it could be correlated to tunneling. So here the process is, you know, these three arrows, one, two, three, describes a situation where you take, in total, one electron hops from wire J to J plus one, let's say from the right moving to the left moving mode. And of course, this costs a finite amount of momentum. But then this amount of momentum can be compensated by creating two spin waves, charge density waves, 2kF processes. So there are three electrons hopping from between Fermi points here. You can write the process in this complicated way here. And you can just, if you do the algebra of momentum conservation, so when momentum is going to be conserved, which value of 2kF, it will be precisely 2kF equal to B over 3. So that means nu equal to 1/3. So there is a process that works here to conserve momentum. And trivial generalization is to introduce integer m. So I imagine now that I go to even lower densities, and I consider a situation where I take an electron from here to here, but then I backscatter m electrons, not just one. Be two. So for any m, this process will conserve momentum at a filling factor of 1 over an odd number, 2m plus 1. This corresponds to the Laffian sequence of fractional plateaus. So I like to argue that this is really the fractional quantum Hall effect, which happens when this operator, this tunneling becomes important. So again, close, if we make the same assumption that this perturbation is small compared to Fermi energy, then we can linearize the spectrum close to these Fermi points and use tricks of one-dimensional physics for normalization.
Yeah. So this Laffian sequence trick is just a mathematics of shifted parabolas, or is there some? I missed an important point on it. So the way you get the sequence, you just kind of have an equally spaced parabolas and.
I consider the processes, so maybe it's unclear. Maybe I'll go to the next slide. Okay. Because, so the processes that I consider, so I have wire, J plus J plus 1. I am transferring now one electron from one wire to the other, but I'm backscattering M electrons. So in the integer quantum Hall effect, you don't backscatter any, M is equal to 0. Now for nu equal to 1/3, you backscatter one electron. But now suppose you backscatter two electrons. So this, the question is, when would this conserve momentum? So you're gaining momentum from here, so that it will conserve momentum at even lower density. This is the question, when momentum is conserved? Momentum along the wires.
I don't know.
But for simplicity, nu equal to 1/3 is sufficient to understand the full story.
And just a notational question, what does upper script index m stands for?
Oh, to the power of m, because...
Power, so you are considering more than three particles?
So, in just this case, it's m equal to 1.
Yes, m.
So, and also you have to invert those arrows, there is inconsistency. So, for example, the j, while psi j left mover is this one, to the power of 1. This represents this arrow here.
Yes.
And then here, there are two arrows coming out, so this is 2. So, here is m plus 1, it's 1 plus 1.
Yes, that's fine, but you are considering, so m is just 1, or you consider more than 3 particle schedules?
Let's consider n equal to 1 for simplicity. This corresponds to nu equal to 1.
Sorry, I'm going to ask the king of stupid questions, okay? So why are you actually concerned with momentum conservation? So for the integer Hall effect, you are backscattering from right movers into left movers,
and
you are fine with not conserving momentum, right? And that's the magnetic field that sort of does the U-turn, right?
Why do you open a gap exactly here? Because these two guys touch because at the same k. You go from left moving to right moving at the same k. There is the same momentum conservation already here.
Ah, okay, so they're the same k because you kind of took the difference between k, you know, into magnetic field, then you're fine.
Yeah, I'm just still conserving momentum, but not with one electron. I need more electrons to do that.
There is a Lorentz boost. If you go between wires, the magnetic field gives you a Lorentz boost, and that compensates for it.
No, that's what I'm saying. So
there is a good momentum conservation if you consider also the Lorentz boost, right?
That's exactly the shift part.
Yeah.
All right.
And another question. I mean, do you need electrons to really tunnel, or you can have just on interaction processes like crash processes?
You need them to really tunnel. Otherwise,
all the other internal scattering look like kind of interaction processes.
Yes, but you will need them to tunnel, and this will I'll tell you exactly what. Basically, you need it in your quasi particles to be able to move in the plane, not just on the lines. All right, so this is very complicated set of formulas. I don't want to go through all of them, but just to say that, well, this is the process that we wrote. Now you can, that's very simple. I want to emphasize bosonization, basically replace psi by e to the phi. You have left for every left or right mover and for every wire, you have corresponding boson. And after you do some algebra, the crucial thing is that you can bring the system exactly to the same structure. So you can define some new bosons, phi Tweedle, which is, let's say this is phi Tweedle, combination of left and right moving bosons in wire J. You can define another left moving boson in the next wire. And this correlated many electron process actually maps to a simple process in which you couple two new kind of composite particles. So this is this picture. So the wire J, for example, now you can think of it like before as a stride. It contains new left and right moving fields. It's not just electrons, but more complicated entities. You can think of them like edge states of fractional sample. And what you are doing is actually to couple the left moving mode of one stride with the right moving mode of the next one. This is exactly what happens from here due to momentum conservation. And it reads like, if you had a Hermitian conjugate, this cosine of phase difference. So now imagine that these perturbations are relevant. They open a gap, just as for free fermions. So you get the same situation in bulk gap. So in the links between wires, there appear gaps. And still there remain these unpaired modes due to the switching of partners, left and right movers. So we get double state states.
So yeah. Strictly speaking, this is like some very strongly irrelevant interaction. For like large amp, you have to point split this with many derivatives.
Yeah.
And that's all encoded in bosonization.
Yeah, so you need strong interactions to make it relevant nonetheless.
But does it explain the size of the, let's say, the fractional gap? This is an order in some t, so does this explain?
This is not the strength of this method to explain the gap. You can do power counting. But because the original system is not very anisotropic. So I believe that this kind of calculation will not tell you about the isotropic limit. So we are in the very anisotropic limit. So we can learn certain things.
So with higher n, it gets less and less relevant, right?
Yeah.
So, but that was the remark before. But to make it more relevant, you really have to crank up the interaction, right?
Yeah.
But at that point, don't you break already this bosonization description, or can you still be within the limits of bosonization?
Well, I think so. So the answer is you can be there. But one has to go to the details to see this explicitly. So I've presented the model for an integer quantum Hall effect, and now presented just fractional version of it. Let's see that it gives us the main ingredients of a fractional quantum Hall effect. So what are the bulk excitations of this state? So we have a state which is controlled by this coupling between left and right movers of neighboring regions. So what would be the bulk excitations of this? So crucial thing is that we map the problem to one-dimensional problem, to set of commuting one-dimensional link problems. Each one of them is just boson, so free boson with a cosine. It's called sine-Gordon model. So what are the excitations of the sine-Gordon model? These are basically solitons. So you can think that the cosine perturbation, this cosine that we wrote before, becomes relevant. So you can think of it semi-classically, the field difference sits in the is locked to the minima. So this is X, one of the links. However, the system can actually hop from one minima to the other. It costs finite amount of energy, but this is the leading, this is the lowest excitation that you can think about, apart from this non-topological excitations. Now, again, using bosonization, which is very simple, you know that the physical meaning of the derivative, the spatial derivative of this boson field is density, electron density. So you can ask, what is the total charge in such an excitation, total Q? So you have to integrate over x of the density rho, which means integrate over x of the derivative, dx of this phase. And you see, because of the cosine, there is a quantization in the jump of this phase difference. And this is how you conclude that there is a quantized charge of these particles. And it's given by exactly 1 over 2m plus 1. It could be equal to 1 if for m equal to 0. But just rho depends on m, just as it should. So this is Laughlin, a way, it's a one-dimensional way to see Laughlin quasi-particles. Now, we got this excitation, just a comment, we got this excitation in one-dimensional system. So it sounds very similar to, we know that there are fractional excitations in the polyacetylene chain, this carbon chain with possible dimerization. So there are two possible dimerizations of the chain, and you can ask what happens in domain wall. Since the chain is half filled, we know that a domain wall between two different dimerized states carries a fractional charge, 1/2. So it seems like kind of very similar, but I want to emphasize an important difference. So suppose that you have a coupled wire construction of polyacetylene. So you have many of them, one on top of the other. And you have some soliton somewhere in one of the wires. Can it actually hop to the next chain? So answer is that it cannot hop, because in this case there are two different local orders. You can distinguish whether the system is in this minima or in this minima for the polyacetylene. There are two different dimerized states. So in order for this soliton to hop to another chain, you have to flip infinite number of dimers to the right of this point. So, however, the situation is different in this construction of the quantum Hall case, because there's totally no physical, these two minimas are just the same. There is no physical way to distinguish them. So this means that quasi-particles can actually hop from wire to wire, perpendicular to the wires in the perpendicular direction, via some local operators. You don't need any non-local operators, and turns out that simple electron backscattering, psi dagger left J, psi right J, it does the job. So again, here there are many formulas, I'm not going through them, but it basically tells you that simple bosonization shows you that this local operator, such that one electron backscattering, if you rewrite it in terms of the fields that we have just introduced, in terms of these link variables, will not only involve the pinned value, which appears in the cosine, but also this guy, which differs just by a plus here, and it is the conjugate of this field, therefore it changes it, it does not commute with it. So you can work this out, that each time that you apply this operator at some position x, so you are reducing the charge in one link by a fractional amount and increasing it in the next link. So this operator is really quasi-particle tunneling perpendicular to the wires. So you can just write it down explicitly. It's all under control. That's the message here. And finally, let's go back to this notion of, we say that these fractional topological states are obtained degenerate ground state if you put them on a torus, for example. How you can see that from here? So you can apply, you can think what would be the operator. So if I roll this set of wires to a cylinder and then into a torus, what happens if I apply this quasi-particle hopping now around the torus? This would be UY. UY is the product over J over all this product on a ground state. So claims that this operator is going to change the ground state. It actually will change the charge of one wire by a fractional amount, by one third, for example. So it will take you three times to apply it till you will get back to the same state. So message here is that you can work out all these very complex statements just using one-dimensional physics and understand fractional quantum law.
So if you look on these phases, this pi and 3 pi, where is actually the charge located if you look at real space? Is it going to work in the link?
On the links between wires. If you can create wires, they're not located on the wires, but rather on the link between the wires.
But this kink that you did, it's making a local charge at a certain position between the two wires.
Yeah, it is somewhere, it can move along the wires.
But it's localized. Parallel to the, the direction of the wire, it's like a...
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So, this is depends on details, the actual localization.
Yeah.
This is not what this method is going to tell you. All right, so we have kind of, I've presented this method. Actually, I like it's a bit small, you can not see this. So actually, Anton wrote some comment on this Journal of Lab for Condensed Matter about paper, actually the paper that included these formulas using wire construction for the first time by Eran Sagi and collaborators. And I like the way that he puts it. So this wire construction, you can think about as kind of topological quantum Lego. So really, want to construct complicated states using elementary units, which are very simple. These wires are really one-dimensional objects, are simple, and they take into account interactions in a very straightforward way. So let me give a couple of examples, apart from fractional quantum Hall, what people have been doing with this. So, first thing, You know that the integer quantum Hall case was generalized for the first time to basically to topological insulator by adding symmetries. The question: what happens if we add symmetries to the problem? Time reversal, for example, and all these states have been classified in the non-interacting case. So, question is whether we can classify actually strongly correlated fractional states. So you can actually use precisely this wire construction, and in the first step, so this is kind of this column here, you can give examples of each one, each symmetry class. For example, this symmetry class, this is just a quantum Hall. What we discussed is this is a wire construction example of it. Very small, so each thing like this square is like a quantum wire. It contains left and right movers, and this one is the next wire contains left and right movers, and the lines show that you connect left of one wire to right of the second one. This is precisely this picture I just elucidated. Well, you can add symmetry, time reversal symmetry, for example. To account for that, you need to add spin. So in this picture, there is two left movers with spin up and two spin down in each wire, and two right movers with the two spins. And what you have to do to get to the quantum spin Hall state is to couple both up and down particles just in the same way. However, as I showed you, it's very simple to generalize phases, at least theoretically, to fractional versions of them. Just essentially by replacing e to the I phi by e to the I phi tweedle. So we show how to get the fractional quantum Hall effect. But using this method, for example, you can immediately see a fractional topological insulator version of a quantum spin Hall, which was not observed experimentally yet. It would be very interesting at some point to see this. People also looked, for example, in about Chern insulators. So we have the first model for Chern insulator, which is Haldane model, so quantum Hall effect without a magnetic field. So does there exist a fractional version of it? So with this wire construction, it is very simple to formulate such a thing. So you need actually quite complicated, also Haldane's model is quite complicated. So you need here four unit cell, so four wires. There is positive magnetic field between the first two, then zero magnetic field, then negative magnetic field between wire three and four. And also you need to invoke both electron and hole type wires. So this will be wire number one, wire number two, that it is shifted because of as before. And then number wire three is hole-like. And wire number four is electron-like and is shifted back to the left because of the negative magnetic field. And tuning the tunnelings T and T prime, you can easily get a state which has the edge states. But again, you in this case, you don't have this infinite shift of momentum to the right. And it's basically trivial to fractionalize this state using bosonization. So the last example I'd like just to give, how you can apply this method, is actually to explain very, very complicated states that people have discussed in the context of spin liquids in a rather simple way. Yeah.
So just by fractionalization, you mean that you just construct this pipe wheel just in a way similar you did before, and then get another sequence out of that, or is that what you mean? Right?
You just replace a single particle process by a multi-particle process, which is legitimate by momentum conservation.
Right. Okay.
And if it is relevant to us, what are you going to get?
And the sequence will be very similar sequence, right?
Almost identical, yeah. There's no... okay, so just few words about spin liquids. So, you know, topological phases are not just restricted to electrons. You can have also insulators just with quantum spins located on lattice sides, and you can have them not ordered magnetically due to frustration. The first one is due to Anderson. He first proposed the spin liquid in form of a resonating valence bond. But then I'd like to discuss this proposal of Kalmayer and Laughlin. So they suggested actually an alternative ground state to the anti-ferromagnetic problem on triangular lattice, spin 1/2. And they claim that, that this is going to be bosonic analog of the quantum Hall effect. So it will have fractional spin excitations, and it will have edge states, also only spins. We don't have any charges in this case. They call it a chiral spin liquid. So basically, I will explain very briefly what is their argument. But what I want to say is that this is really hand waving. And using wire approach, at least you have a tool to actually to go from the Hamiltonian and actually say something about what you really get or not. So, but this is how it started. So, roughly speaking, you have some S dot S interaction on the triangular lattice. You can map spin 1/2 to hardcore bosons. So if there is spin up, there is a boson. If there is spin down, there is no boson. But there's no two bosons on the same side, so this is quite hardcore. So these bosons hop, you can, and it's positive J here, means anti-ferromagnetic interaction. Well, you can change, you can make some gauge transformation, change J to minus J, but also put a half flux quantum per triangle for these bosons. So a conclusion of this is actually exact mapping, is that this problem is equivalent to hardcore bosons hopping on the triangular lattice with a pi flux per triangle. And also these bosons, because there's no magnetic field, so there is equal probability for spin up and spin down, means that bosons are half filled, and there is, for each unit cell, there is two pi flux, or one flux quantum. So it means that these bosons are in the magnetic field of corresponding to mu equal to 1/2. So, if you are Laughlin, then you just immediately write down this wave function. which is just the same thing as the original one, but with a two here, not three, which corresponds, which is consistent with bosonic statistics. So this has been of great interest to a lot of people. Been looking for this in very many systems. Actually, it's not correct that it's the ground state in the triangular lattice, but some recently, last year, there have been a very convincing numerical calculations show that actually this stabilized, this chiral spin liquid state is stabilized on Kagome. So can we say actually something simple without invoking numerics from this new perspective? So we do not have any more quantum wires. We do not have really magnetic field. We don't have charges hopping. It's a slightly different problem. So what do we mean by wire construction? We simply mean that we can take a triangular lattice and make it very anisotropic. So imagine that the coupling of between chains along chains J here is dominant. And then we will add some inter-chain coupling, similar to the all kinds of couplings that we added before. So if you start with such chains, so this is a well-known problem. So Heisenberg chain contains, again, left and right moving gapless excitations known as spinons. And they are represented by this. So the spin operator can be represented in terms of the right moving and left moving spin current operators. There is also this standard field, which I will not discuss, associated with the up-down type of fluctuations. So what I'm saying is we do have a well-known theory for the chains, and now we can couple the chains. So how do you couple the chains? You have the S dot S interaction, just Heisenberg interaction in the triangular lattice. So it's here. So you have the Heisenberg interaction between the neighboring spins on neighboring chains, and you can rewrite it in terms of a coupling between the left and the right moving now spin current. And this is represented here. So this is what the left moving and the right moving modes of each chain. So, however, to understand the current spin liquid, it turns out that you need to invoke a coupling which does break time reversal symmetry. But still, everything is SU2 symmetric. Nothing breaks SU2 symmetry. So this S dot S cross S, where I, J, and K belong to an elementary triangle, let's say this one, or and all of them, this is called spin chirality, was introduced by Wen, Z, and Wichek. So actually, if you bosonize this operator, you'll get almost the same thing, but with some minus here. So what is the overall picture here? This all that I will say. So these interactions actually couple the left and right moving modes of neighboring chains, but it's not as simple as before that we only couple, let's say, left moving mode of wire J with right moving mode of wire J plus one. We also do the opposite thing. However, it depends now on parameters which phase you are going to stabilize. So whether the Heisenberg interaction or the spin chirality interaction are larger or weaker, there is a tendency to different phases. So if actually you would have just dominating Heisenberg coupling, then both these lines and the dashed lines would be as strong in the end. Whereas when the spin chirality operator dominates, then you can prove that these dashed lines essentially flow to zero. This is again physics of one dimension, and you can say things with confidence. So we'll end up with a coupling between the left, only with left moving and right moving modes of neighboring wires. And in this way, you will end up with, you can see explicitly the edge state, which is going to be described by freely moving a spin current in one end, and another one with opposite chirality in the other end. And you can actually construct all possible, you can verify all predictions of this theory using this approach, and even calculate some things. And just you can also actually argue why is it that this state is stabilized on Kagome but not on triangular lattice. And this is about actually effect of additional relevant operators which I did not write. All right, so I didn't want to get into details about this, but claim is that it seems like this wire construction is very general. Basically, take your favorite topological state. Maybe the wire construction would be very simple approach for you to understand it. But now let me, in the last few minutes, discuss possible ways, some simple things that you could do and bring this towards experiment. So the idea we have been discussing how to simulate a two-dimensional system with many parallel wires. But that the essential physics was just coupling, that was one-dimensional. Basically, the physics on each link was important. So you can couple two wires in different ways to get integer or fractional quantum Hall effect, and even more complex states that I did not discuss, like non-abelian states. But if so, why do you really need two dimensions? You can actually work in one dimension directly. Say you have just two wires. Okay, so let's look at in one-dimensional systems now. So let me compare. For example, let's say that I would like to have fractional conductance in one-dimensional wires. Well, let me compare the quantization of conductance in the quantum Hall effect and in short one-dimensional constrictions. So in this case, you have two-dimensional sample. The quantization is perfect, so this is good for metrology just because of distance between the opposite chiralities. In one dimension, we also have quantization, also a very remarkable thing, but well, it's not as perfect as here, because here this quantization is protected by system, here this point contact being very clean and very adiabatic. But still, the question is, can this be fractionalized as this was? So let me use an example, a system that many people are interested in recently. So let's take some quantum wires. So we have spinful wires, but we had a rush back interaction. So there were few talks that introduced this kind of systems. And so this shifts the two parabolas of spin up and spin down horizontally, and we add magnetic field, which opens now, which mixes up and down and opens the gap here. So when you look at this picture, you can immediately compare it to what we had before and ask basically what's the difference, if at all. So basically there's no difference, it's the same thing, except that this quantum wire spin is just the two-wire version of this wire construction of topological states. So the two wires correspond to two spin species. And so what here was magnetic field, orbital magnetic field, here it's Rajba. And what here is electron tunneling between wires corresponds to here something that flips the spin from up to down. So that's Zeeman field, which does not commute with Rajba. Term. So we'd like to ask what would be manifestation. So this thing can fractionalize, as we know very well. So what would be manifestations of fractionalization here? So first of all, what's the simplest way to simplest measurable quantity in the system, actually, which everybody's trying to measure, but nobody has succeeded yet. So if you measure the conductance through this wire, what would be the influence of this helical gap? So it's called helical. Would be the influence would be some reduction of the conductance. So as you tune the chemical potential into the gap, the conductance should be reduced. So G is 2 square over H, and then inside the gap here is reduced to 1 square over H. This is ideal. Nobody has observed it, mainly because these systems have many impurities, I guess. In one dimension, every impurity is going to destroy everything. But nevertheless, let's look at this just theoretical curve. So, we have just discussed in the many wire case, we have discussed this region of Fermi energy as integer quantum Hall effect. Actually, this is also the conductance of integer quantum Hall effect. But we know that when you put interaction, the system is very rich. The integer quantum Hall effect is just part of one member of a family of fractional states. We can get, for example, states with fractional conductance of 1/3. So will this be happening in the one-dimensional quantum wire? So doing some calculation which just follows the ideas that I displayed, the conclusion is the following. So you need the wire to be strongly interacting. So people have here asked, I mean, how strongly interacting it has to be for this operator, for this highly irrelevant operator to become relevant. So what you need for the experts, the Luttinger parameter is to be below 1/3. So Luttinger parameter is equal to 1 for non-interacting electrons. So I don't know, sometimes people talk about 1/2, Luttinger parameter of 1/2. This is already strongly interacting. You need a bit more. But then this instability will happen. Of course, you still need the wire to be very clean, and their contacts to the leads to be, to be adiabatic. So the prediction is that, well, so this is what we discussed before, we can view it as integer quantum Hall gap. However, if you now tune the density to 1/3, so now I'm this density, so you will have a new gap opening, and the conductance will be fractional. It turns out that the conductance is not just 1/3, as in quantum Hall, it's a different answer because basically because the left and right loopers are so much nearby. This is some exact result. Conductance would be 1/5, and for the next plateau of 1/5, the conductance would be 1/13, or whatever. So in principle, this is very would be very interesting to observe experimentally. Physical meaning of this fractional conductance is that only the fractional mode is spread, this E2, not electron, but rather this E2 di phi twiddle, whatever it means, like the edge state of fractional state. Okay, and one more, so this is, I showed you one option to take this wire construction of topological states and actually make, talk of a system which is precisely described by D.
Yeah, there was an argument that you know, in principle, you are not supposed to measure interactions in conduction if you in the DC limit when you go far away and the contacts are non-interacting. How does this survive?
Yeah, so there was an argument that you can change the Luttinger parameter k inside a quantum wire. Initially, there was some paper that said that the conductance depends on it, but conclusion was that there was no dependence on the conductance on the Luttinger parameter. The conductance is just given by E square over H per transmitted channel. So what is going on here? What is going on is that we do not have all channels being transmitted. This process that happens in the middle is just, there is the back scattering from left right to right mover, which just changes this. So this argument, the arguments assume that each chiral mode interacts with all others, but it's perfectly transmitted. Mm-hmm. But here it's not the case. Here you do have, by hand, you do have some actual back scattering, which not by impurity, but rather by spin orbit coupling, like by magnetic field. You have an important play. You have part of the system that is back scattering. It is not in the those experiments. This is crucial here, crucial difference.
And the conductance doesn't depend on a lot of your parameter. It just changes above, below some critical.
So now the conductance is, for example, given by this formula, by 1/5, and it will not depend anymore on larger parameter. But the thing is, it just depends on, for example, M. So there was this various processes, one electron is back scattered, or one electron and then two electrons. So it just depends on this M. This M is basically new. Is 1 over 2 m plus 1. But so there is an important back scattering process. And furthermore, there is no additional dependence on that.
So you said that the scattering modality, the interface going into the gray area, that's like if you measure where the resistance drops.
Yeah, so it happens exactly when this backscattering starts becoming relevant, because it's irrelevant in the leads.
Aaron, just also a technical question. In order to get different amps involve different number of particles in a scattering process, yeah. Right? Are you making a statement that all those relevant aggregators which generate this multi-particle becomes relevant, all of them, for k smaller than 1/3?
No,
or is this is the lowest?
This is the lowest one.
This is the lowest
one. I'm just talking about
that condition. So let's say for the state was 1/5, you need an even more stringent.
I think condition. That's 1/5. I think the formula is
okay.
But maybe it's not correct.
Okay.
This is at least for one case. Okay, so there is one more option. Let me just finish with some additional direction that people are trying experimentally. Just look at, again, talking about two chains. Now you can make it more explicit by actually going to lattice models. So there are less questions. We're not sensitive to cutoffs and things like this. We can be very precise in defining the model, and we can actually implement two-level ladders with cold atoms. So with cold atoms, they can do anything they want, basically. So they can do particles, bosons, or fermions hopping on a two-level ladder, and they can even create so-called synthetic magnetic field. So this is again two wire version of the wire construction that one could use to look for fractional phases. So the Hamiltonian is simply tight binding with this additional phase which corresponds to the flux phi per plaquette. And basically, it's exactly the same thing, except for lattice effects. Now, the momentum is between minus pi and pi, and we might want or might not want to talk about lattice effects, and here we don't want to. And the claim is that if you include in the interactions with finite range psi, so and you take the interaction to be large enough, you can stabilize this already in two-leg ladder. This is kind of exact claim, because this problem is one-dimensional. Say things with confidence that depending on the interaction range psi, you can stabilize phases with smaller and smaller field of factor, so more particle interactions. But for bosons, so this actually, this is bosons, fermions. For bosons, actually, you already get fractional state with on-site interaction, actually on-leg interaction. Okay, so what can be measured in this kind of experiments, what was measured. So they construct these ladders, and they know, actually, that's interesting. When you have magnetic field penetrating each flux, then there is kind of diamagnetic response. There are currents going around, and they know how to measure these currents. And here, well, they're plotting the current, let's say, as function of actually of the T-pair, the interchain coupling. What they argue here is that actually there is a kind of Meissner phase. There is a Meissner phase, like in a type 2 superconductor, where the currents perfectly screen, are proportional to the external magnetic field, and screen it, and then there are vortices. This is what this experiment discusses, but my point is that the current is measurable. The current around the bladder is something which is measurable. So now we can ask what would be realizations or manifestations of some fractional state, either bosons or fermions. So if you calculate the current, the chiral current, so you see that depending on the, if you make the tunneling between chains very small, basically the current becomes constant along lines with so the current depends on the density and density of particles on the ladder and on the flux phi, but actually it behaves in this way, so it does not change if I both increase density and flux, so already filling factor here appears. So for nu equal to 1 you can do the calculation exactly, but for any nu you can do, you can show using bosonization that actually measuring contours of the current can be used to extract the filling factor. So the thing is that with these cold atoms, it's, even that you have some fractional state, how do you know? What can you measure? So what they know to measure is the chiral current, and I'm telling that I think that this is the simplest thing that they can measure. That's how the current depends on particle density and on flux. So once they will see fractional quantum Hall, then one can go some steps beyond, on abelian states, etc. But let me summarize my talk. So this wire construction gives a really simple approach to understand highly complicated states. It's easy to fractionalize. So if you know a non-interacting phase, should there exist a fractional version of it? And it's not so crazy actually to think of experiments that are based on this approach. Maybe this will have some consequences soon. Thank you for your attention.